So today we are going to start a new topic that is called strength of material. Okay, so this is today is the introduction part of this topic, and as the lecture will be progressed, and one more thing, if there is more support from you, then again we will discuss this topic in detail in next subsequent lectures. So today we are going to talk about the introduction part of this topic, strength of material. So what is, first of all, you should understand, what do you mean by strength? Strength means it is a property of the material. Okay, it is a property of the material, and it is constant for a particular material. Suppose you take a material wood and another material steel. So if you keep on loading on a particular material, it will fail. It will fail at a particular limit. Okay, the maximum stress at which the material is failing, at which the material is collapsing, that maximum stress in the material is called as strength of material. So we should always allow the stress in the material should always less than the maximum stress in the material. I mean, it should be not exceed the strength of the material, then the material will be fail. So the gate point of view, this subject is very important, and the weightage of this subject is generally this is 8 to 10 marks. So this is 8 to 10 marks weightage of the subject. And if you want to talk about the books, so these are different types of books you can use, that is called POP, and this Timoshenko, Beers and Johnson's, Ryder. Okay, and I can recommend some additional book, that is Ramarutham. Okay, and then some another books I am not recalling it now. Another book will be there, that is, I think, let me check later on to tell you the later on the books. Okay, and some of the objective book if you talk about, that is Rai and Mishra, Gupta and Gupta, it is very important objective book, Gupta and Gupta. And second one, third one is Khurmi, fourth one is R. Agar. Okay, and this is Jairam Reddy. So these are the five objective book you want to do, and it will help you to crack any competitive exam. So first of all, let's talk about the strength. What is strength? Strength is called, it is a property of the material. You just imagine, what is strength? Suppose I am talking about a human strength, myself strength. My strength is what? So I can take what, I can know what I can do, what I cannot do. Okay, and I know my potential. The potential is particularly is called a strength, and it is, my potential is not same as another person potential. Okay, so we can relate that one. So my potential, my strength is my strength. Okay, it is different from other body strength. So that is all. This is a property of the particular material. And actually, when you are going to design any structure, and in the design we take this one as a primary factor. Okay, strength we are taking a primary design factor into consideration. So resistance offered, that is, what is the strength? Resistance offered by the body to the external forces against failure. Okay, that is called strength. Suppose a body you take, suppose this is my body, and you are applying a axial load onto this body. You are applying a axial load onto this body. And what will happen? Some internal resistance. Suppose you take any cross section part, and suppose I am drawing this part now. What will happen? This is the load acting on this body, and there is some resistance will be offered. The material, if you molecular level you see, is molecules and each particle will give a resistance to this external load. And that resistance, if you find out the resultant of this resistance, that is called, we are taking as R. And according to the Newton's third law, every action has equal and opposite reaction. That's why I'm talking this one is equal to P. And this resistance per unit area of this material is called as strength, or that is called stress. Stress we are going to in different thing. But actually strength is what, this is resistance. Okay, first of all, this is the resistance offered by the material or by body to the external forces. That is called strength. And when at failure, okay, at failure we can also, you can write this sentence in another way. Strength is a material property. It is a what? It is a property of a material, and it is a constant for a given material. It is constant for a given material. Suppose you take wood, that is have different strength as compared to aluminium, as compared to gold, as compared to steel. So that they have particular strength. Okay, just a mild steel, its strength we can take as 250 megapascal. Okay, so So that is the thing. So better we can say the strength is can be defined as it is the maximum stress developed at failure. Okay, suppose you are taking one material and we are keep on loading on this material P. Okay, we are keep on increasing the loading on this particular material. Suppose this is we are taking as wood, and at some particular time, what will happen? The wood is going to be fail. Okay, wood is going to be fail, and we have to actually see what is the stress level at the corresponding failure time. That maximum stress which developed by increasing the load, that maximum stress which developed, that maximum stress which developed due to the increasing load, that is called a strength of material. That is called the strength of the material, means wood, strength of the wood. Okay, that is called maximum stress developed at failure. For example, if you in the concrete design, if you take M20, M is stands for what? M is stands for this is mix, and 20 is what is called? This is called characteristic strength. What is characteristic strength? That is we are going to see in the building materials. So M20 means mix, and A20 is stands for the characteristic strength. And what is characteristic strength? Means the strength of that concrete cube at 28 days. Okay, at 28 days we are recording this one as 20 megapascal. Okay, that is the maximum stress will develop in the concrete at failure, for example. Similarly, if you talk about the mild steel, that is generally we are taking Fe 250. Okay, Fe 250, and here this 250 is representing it is the yield stress. Okay, it is representing the yield stress of the mild steel, that is 250 megapascal. And whatever the size of the diameter of the bar you take, that does not matter. Suppose you are taking 6 mm diameter, 8 mm diameter, 20 mm diameter, all has same strength. So if you vary the diameter, most of the student think if you change the diameter of the rod, then the strength of the mild steel will change. No, that does not matter at all. Okay, every diameter bar you take, that is has 250 megapascal. Similarly, you take HYST bar, high yield deformed bar, that is Fe 415. For our design in RCC, we are going to look in detail this one thing. And there, the yield strength of the material you are taking this one is 415 megapascal. Okay. So strength, actually, I already told you, this is a primary design parameter. When you are going to design any structure, and the strength is taken account a primary factor in the design. Okay. So strength is a primary design parameter. Whatever I'm saying, that is very much important. And when you will able to see the numericals, GATE or this objective books, then these things are very essential. Okay. Now you talk about the stiffness. Okay. Stiffness means what? This is actually a secondary parameter in design. Okay. Strength is a primary design parameter, and stiffness is the secondary design parameter. Okay, so this is actually called secondary design parameter. And strength is what? Strength is maximum stress at failure. Okay, or we can say resistance which develop in the material at failure. But stiffness is what? Resistance of member against deformation, that is called stiffness. Okay, when actually spring you take, okay, this is a spring. If you attach a load here, and this load is, suppose you are increasing this load, what will happen? Then spring will try to deform. So initial level this one, now the spring will go to some other level. Okay, suppose the load is going here, there is some deformation will be generated, that is deformation, that is del x. Okay, and that is called load per unit deformation is called as stiffness of the material. Load per unit deformation means how much load is required to for unit deformation, that is called stiffness. Okay, in torsion that is called angular deformation. Okay, and in this stress strain or linear elastic material, when you are applying a load, when the deformation, that is called longitudinal deformation. Okay, so if the member is very stiff means what? Very stiff means what? Deformation will be less. And it is very flexible means one, deformation will be more. Very flexible. If you talk about any rigid material, Okay, for example, you talk take any mild steel and you rubber. Okay, so the deformation you talk deformation will be very high in the class of flexible material. Suppose one parameter I am talking about the carbon content. So if you increase the carbon content in a material, what will happen? The strength of the material will increases. Okay, strength of the material will increases. But what will at the same time the ductility of the material will decreases. The ductility of the material will decreases means what? Suppose in their design you are taking mild steel as rod. Okay, mild steel is steel rod, and someone is taking HYST as rod. What will happen when actually he is designing the structure? Suppose that in some case the structure is going to fail. So mild steel has less carbon content, but the HYST has more carbon content. So mild steel has less strength, but HYST has more strength. But ductility of the mild steel is more, but ductility of the HYST is less. So when the material will be fail, it will give sufficient warning before the failure. That's why in most of the structure we are taking mild steel Fe 250 as bar, because its ductility will more, it will give more deformation, more sufficient warning, more time to the residents who is living inside this room to escape from that one. By HYST strength is more, that is no doubt, but it will not give sufficient warning. Okay, it will not give sufficient, it immediately, it will not immediately, but it will fail. Okay, so but mild steel it will deform continuously. So after you can also go for the serviceability parameter, you can design, you can make it perfect. Okay, then you can put some safeguard against this failure. So that is the thing, mild steel we are taking as a bar. So already I told you stiffness is a secondary design parameter. Okay, primary design parameter we are going for the strength, and secondary design parameter is called stiffness. There is some assumption has been taken in strength of material. There has been some assumption. You can write something in your chart box so I can keep on checking the chart box. Okay, is it everything okay na? Okay, fine. So now some assumption has been taken in strength of material. Okay, what are the assumption has been taken? First of all, all the materials which we are actually finding out the strength, the material should be continuous in nature. Okay, so first assumption is talking about, this is the first assumption, all the materials are continuous. Continuous means what? There is no cracks, no voids present in the material. Okay, if there is some voids will be there, when you are actually applying this load will be not uniformly distributed. Okay, so as long as we can assume there is no voids, no cracks are present, then what will happen? The load will be uniformly distributed. Okay, that is the one thing. So first assumption we are taking, there is no cracks are present in this material and there is no voids are present. The material is continuously throughout, means the mass is continuously distributed along the material. Okay, that is the first assumption. Second assumption we are taking, all the materials are homogeneous and isotropic. All the materials is homogeneous, isotropic. These two things we are understanding separately. First one is homogeneous. Homogeneous, homo means same, and genius means that is called origin. Means it is same origin. The material should have same origin. Okay. Means the, suppose we are taking about this wood, the wood must have same origin, means the origin of the wood is where? That is called tree. So all the materials coming from single source, that is called homogeneous. For example, I am taking this wood, the wood must be come from this one source, that is called tree is the source. Iron is the one source, that is called iron ore. Okay, so but brass is not a homogeneous. Okay, because brass is, there is carbon. Okay, this is the alloy. This is the alloy of carbon and zinc. Different source. Brass is alloy. We are actually preparing from this carbon and zinc. That is the alloy. So this is not a homogeneous. So aluminium, pure gold, these are all homogeneous material. They are actually, the source is one, single one. For engineering purpose, we can understand this one homogeneous. So at any point in one direction, the properties must be same. Properties means what? The strength, the bulk modulus, let alone Poisson ratio, okay, and all these properties of the material will be same at any point, but in a particular direction. Suppose I am talking about the x direction here, So stress will be same in x direction. So this all the every point the stress will be same. Every point the stress will be same. But if you talk about in y direction, it will not be same. So homogeneous means at any point in one direction, the properties must be same. Second, we are going to understand about the what do you mean isotropic. So isotropic, it is actually related to some directional property. Okay, this is a directional property. So what is my isotropic? Isotropic means at one particular point and in infinite direction the properties will be same. Suppose I am taking this point, at this point what will happen? All these properties in infinite direction will be sigma, sigma, sigma. But you talk about this point, the property will not be same as compared to this one, but here in infinite direction the property will be same, sigma 1, sigma 1, sigma 1. Okay, so what are the examples of the isotropic materials? That is fine grains, that is isotropic. Okay, that is iron, aluminium, carbon, gold. Okay, but wood is not an isotropic material. Okay, but it is a homogeneous material. Wood is a homogeneous material, but it is not a isotropic material. Now the assumption has been taken here that all materials are homogeneous and isotropic. Okay, so that is the thing, all materials which are talking about, the materials must be homogeneous material and isotropic. Okay, so if you talk about the now isotropic plus homogeneous material combination, what does that mean? Means what will happen? At any one point in all direction the property will be same. Okay, mean you take any point here and the infinite direction, that what will happen? The property will be same. That is the assumption has been taken in the strength of material. Means at any particular point in infinite direction, if you talk about all our properties sigma, here also sigma, here also, if you take here also sigma, so here also sigma, so all her property will be same. That means assumption. So as per the assumption, what will happen? All the materials are treated as homogeneous and isotropic. Means what will happen? At any point, all direction, the property will be same. Next one, we will talk about the orthotropic. Ortho means what? This ortho means that is called perpendicular, and tropic, this is called directional property. Isotropic, this is directional property. So orthotropic means, suppose this is a material, we are taking stress in x direction, stress in y direction, stress in z direction. So what this mean? So at any one point in perpendicular direction, properties are different. That is called orthotropic. So at any one point, suppose I am talking about this point, suppose this point is A. So at this point, all of them, the stress in x direction is not equal to stress in y direction, stress will be equal, not equal to in z direction. That is called orthotropic material. What are the examples of orthotropic? That is called wood, mica, stratified soil, sedimentary stones, that is called marble, slates, shales, and graphite. These are the various examples of the orthotropic material. Now you talk about the anisotropic and allotropic. So anisotropic means what? At one point in any direction, properties are different. That is, perpendicular direction properties are different, is called orthotropic. But any one point in infinite direction, what will happen? The properties will be different. That is called anisotropic. So materials with, there is what I mean, the material which avoids and crack, that is called anisotropic. Okay, so that is, examples are glass with micro cracks. Okay, concretes. Okay, soil is a stratified material. Stratified soil we have seen. Okay, now that is the thing. Now let's talk about, suppose we are actually applying a load and the stress will be generated. So in which particular direction the material can able to withstand more stress? Suppose this is the first condition, we are applying this stress in this direction, this sigma x, sigma y, and the stress we are applying in this direction, sigma x. So now what will happen? These layers will be separated. As you are applying this stress in y direction, this layer will be separated from this one. But if you compare this one, if you apply the stress in x direction, the layer will be stretched. Okay, So in this, what will happen? The stress in x direction or the resistance in x direction is more than the resistance in y direction. Okay, that is the thing. Now, if you talk about this one, now you change. Now you are applying the compressive stress. Now you are applying the compressive stress in y direction and compressive stress in x direction. Now in this case, what will happen? The material will be bulged. The material will be bulged. Bulge can deep heap kind of formation will be happen. So here the resistance in y direction is more than in compared to x direction. That is called strain. Okay. So here the compressive direction, the strength will be more. Okay, in y direction as compared to this. But if you talk about the tensile, okay, you are just pulling this material. So here is the more chance the material will get separated. The layers will be get separated in this case. So that's why the strength in y direction is less as compared to strength in x direction. Strength in x direction, the material will be stretched. Rather, it will not be separated. So strength in x direction will be, that is, more. Okay. Now the next assumption has been taken. The self weight of the material has been ignored. Self weight of the material is ignored means what happened? Suppose you talk, later on we talk about the stress strain graph. Suppose strain is the, if you draw the strain strain graph, what will happen? Earlier, if you self weight is not ignored, if you consider self weight, this one is called the stress due to the self weight. Okay, so this one is not ignored, but in our analysis, what will happen? We are ignoring the self weight. So we are actually, every graph we are starting from this origin. Okay, the material self weight is, we are actually not taken into consideration. Okay, next, we are fourth assumption is called principle of superposition is valid. Principle of superposition is valid means what? Suppose this is simple supported beam. Okay, now we are applying load 1, load 2, load 3. And self weight of the material, this one, self weight of the material is this one. So what will happen? We are actually combiningly finding the effects of each individual loads onto this particular beam. After that, we are adding all the effects combiningly. So first we are finding the effect of this one. Okay, then we are finding the effect of the second load, then we are finding the effect of the third load. Okay, then we are finding the effect of the self weight. Then what will happen? All we are adding, and then the total final effect we are finding out. That is called superposition principle. Okay, so what is adding all the effect algebraically to get the final effect called super. Algebraically means what will it? Plus minus you have to take. Okay, algebraically means suppose upward direction you are taking positive reaction, downward direction you are taking negative reaction. So that's why you have to take algebraically to get the final effect is called superposition. But there is some limitation of this one. What are the limitation of the superposition principle of superposition? That is valid for linearly elastic member. Okay, non-linear elastic member we cannot apply superposition principle. So as long as we can say the stress is directly proportional to strain, we can apply the superposition principle. Okay, so that is as long as stress is proportional to strain and loading is up to proportionality limit. Later I will talk about what the this proportionality limit, because within this proportionality limit Hooke's law is valid. Okay, Hooke's law is valid. Okay, so stress is directly proportional to strain as long as then we can apply the superposition principle. Here you see in the small graph, so here is stress directly proportional to stress within the proportional limit. So here the superposition principle we can apply. As that there is non-linearity will come in stress strain curve, there is superposition principle cannot be applied. So next we talk about the deformation due to load must be small as possible. So in order to apply the superposition principle, the deformation due to load must be as small as possible. Okay, suppose you are applying a load here. Suppose this P1 is the load and the deformation, suppose here is delta 1. But here suppose you are applying the some loads P2, but deformation will delta 2, and this delta 2 is very much high as compared to this delta 1. So here the superposition principle cannot be applied. But here the superposition principle can be applied. So deformation due to loads, effect of the deformation will be very less. Next, superposition is not valid for deep beams. What do deep means? Suppose the depth of the beam is very high. the depth of the beam is very high. So suppose this is the depth of the beam is very high. So what will happen? So the beam is bending, but what will happen? There is a torsion due to self weight of the beam. The beam is tried to be rotated about its axis. It tried to be rotated about this axis because self weight of the beam is very high. So beam is tried to rotate, or there is torsion kind of thing will form. The beam will be rotated about its own axis. That is called torsion. So this, what will happen? In deep beam, torsion develops due to loading. Therefore, what will happen? Superposition principle is not valid, because torsion, if in deep beam torsion will develop, the material will be deformed. And if the material will be deformed, then the Hooke's law is not valid. If the Hooke's law is not valid, then we can say superposition principle cannot be applied. So what will happen? As the torsion causes torsion, what will happen? The distortion of the material. The material will be distorted. The shape of the material will change. Okay. If the shape of the material will change, that's why the superposition of the principle cannot be applied. So we have to ensure that the shape of the material will not be distorted. Okay. So as the shape goes out in the case of deep beam, so I can say the superposition cannot be applied. So deep beam, if you talk about what is deep beam, so depth of the beam is greater than 750 mm, that is called as deep beam. In the case of long column, superposition principle cannot be applied. Long column means what will be slender column. Slenderness ratio of the column is very high. Okay. So what is happening? Because of the buckling, this is the load, you are an axial load, and this load, what will happen? The member will buckle about this axis, longitudinal axis. So what will happen? The material will be, the buckling deformation will be very high. Okay. So the deformation is not within the limit. So superposition principle is not be applied in the case of long column. Now some question will come. What do you mean by bending and this buckling? So bending means what will happen? Suppose this is the beam, and this is the beam, and this is the transverse load, and thus bending is generally they occur due to the transverse load. Okay, but as far as this buckling, what will happen? Buckling generally occur due to the longitudinal. Suppose this is my column, and we are applying a load, axial load. So what will happen in this case? What will happen? That is the buckling will happen. So same column will be there, but if you apply load in this transverse direction, that is called bending. Okay. But if you start applying load along its longitudinal axis of the member, then that member will start buckling, that is called buckling. Okay. So load perpendicular to axis of the, what is the transverse load? That is called load perpendicular to the axis of the member. So bending, when that due to transverse load, buckling due to the axial or eccentric load. Okay. In fifth case also, we cannot apply superposition principle. Suppose there is sinking of the any support will be there. Suppose this is the fixed beam, and there is the support will be sink. Suppose this is second support is sinking to this one delta. So what will happen? The shape of the beam here gets out of the order. Here also the superposition principle we cannot apply. But if you take about the simply supported beam, so what will happen? The one support, this is one second support, suppose it settled about by this delta. Here the shape is not actually changing. So here the shape is not be out of the order. Here we can apply the superposition principle. Okay. So in the case of simply supported beam, here we can apply the superposition principle. Okay. Now superposition principle also can be applied in torsion in circular shaft. Only in circular shaft we can apply. Why? Suppose this is a shaft. If you apply a torsion, what will happen? The shaft cross section will be remain circular. It will not change. That's why the superposition principle is valid in the case of circular shaft. But if you talk about the non-circular shaft means that is called rectangular shaft. What will happen? There will be the shape of the rectangle will not be same after this torsion applied, after this loading. So there what will happen? The superposition principle is not valid. We cannot apply superposition principle. Next thing is that, assumption is that Saint Venant principle we are using. What is Saint Venant principle? Saint Venant principle, it means if there is sudden change in any parameter, if there is a sudden change in any parameter, that will leads to stress concentration. Okay. Suppose what will happen? This is the member, and suppose this is the member we are designing, and suppose gradually we are increasing the shape of this material and gradually increasing. So what will happen is there is a gradual reduction. We can say there is a gradual reduction of this area, cross section area. If you see the cross sectional area of this part, there is a sudden reduction of this area. So what will happen? There will be stress concentration will be happen. Okay. So how to avoid this one? We can avoid this one by gradual change in the cross section. Okay. We can gradual change in the cross section. So we can avoid the stress concentration of the material. So Saint Venant principle is saying, so whenever you are designing any material, you can design in gradually. So sudden change in the cross sectional part, sudden change in the any parameter, length, breadth, any parameter, it will leads to the stress concentration in that zone. Okay. So what will happen? You can see in the beam test. We can see in the beam test. Suppose you are applying any load. You are applying any load. If you direct apply the load here, so what will happen? The stress concentration will be arises because here the load is not uniformly, actually it is distributing, not uniformly distributing. So the load is concentrating in this particular area. That's why the stress concentration will arises. So all the material are not taking part into the absorbing this load, or they are not taking part in the providing sufficient resistance to the external load. But if you place one plate, and you apply any load, what will happen? The load is gradually now distributed. And what will happen? All these materials or these particles are capable of taking this load, and they will have sufficient resistance to this particular load. So always you have to remember, we have to avoid the stress concentration part. Okay, stress concentration part we have to avoid. How can we avoid? So in all over the design, we avoid stress concentration by gradual, gradual design, or you can gradually we can have some length. There is sudden, we cannot change any length or breadth, anything. So gradually we can design the member so that what will happen, the stress concentration can be avoided. Then next is very important, that is called stress. So somebody will ask, what is stress? Stress, you tell him, that is called resistance force to the applied force. That is called resistance force to the applied force. I mean, this is the stress which actually induced, okay, better you can say that is induced due to the external load internally, that is called stress. Means suppose this is a material, we are applying the load onto the material, what will happen? The stress, the resistance is inducing, the resistance is inducing due to the external load. According to Newton's third law, we are saying this resistance will be equal to the applied load. Okay. Okay, I will upload the video. So that is called stress. So stress, we can say that is called resistance per unit area. That is called resistance per unit area. Or the according to Newton's third law, we are saying the resistance will be equal to the applied load. The resistance will be equal to applied load. So we can say this is P by A. Okay, that is according to the Newton's third law. And R is what is, that is called internal resisting force which is equal to the applied force. And what do you mean nature of the stress? So if you talk about the pressure, nature of pressure is always compressive. Nature of pressure is always compressive. But you talk about the nature of the stress, actually it is based on the nature of the applied force direction. Applied force direction. Suppose you are applying the force direction in this compressive nature. So what is the resistance will be generated, that is called compressive. Suppose you are applying this load in tensile direction, whatever the resistance will be induced, that is called tensile in nature. Okay. So the nature of the stress or nature of the resistance is based on the how you are applying the load, in which direction, whether you are applying tensile or whether you are applying in compressive, whether applying in shear. So nature of the stress is induced or generated, that is based on the how you are applying the load. So this is today lecture. In next class we are talking about the more thing. Okay. So fine, I hope you enjoyed this video. So thank you all, and this video I will be uploaded in this YouTube channel. Later on you can see this video, you can ask me the doubt. Thank you.